Hi, I'm Dr. Veena Chandrashekar, a consultant obstetrician and gynecologist, clinical manager, Medlife. Today's topic of discussion is hypertension in pregnancy, which is one of the major medical conditions affecting the maternal as well as the fetal mortality and morbidity. The percentage of incidence is around 8 to 10%. In a developing nation like India, where ANC visits, that is the antenatal visits and the support, is not very well maintained, the condition comes into focus only when major complications are seen. The types of hypertension in pregnancy would be different types, that is gestational hypertension, preeclampsia, eclampsia, and chronic hypertension. Gestational hypertension is a condition wherein the BP recording is more than or equal to 140 by 90 millimeters of mercury, which is done 4 to 6 hours apart, and ideally it is seen for the first time after 20 weeks of gestation. There is no proteinuria and the BP comes back to normal after the delivery. In preeclampsia, the condition is the same as it is for gestational hypertension, but proteinuria would be present. The third kind of PIH is eclampsia. It is nothing but the condition of preeclampsia, which is complicated by seizures and or coma. And the fourth and the last one would be chronic hypertension. Chronic hypertension is a condition wherein the BP recordings were high from before the pregnancy has started or very early in pregnancy, and the high BP readings would continue even after 12 weeks after the pregnancy is completed, that is the delivery is done. How do you ideally check for BP in a patient? When a pregnant woman comes into the doctor's clinic or the hospital, she is very anxious. So the primary focus would be to make her rest for some time. Ask her to sit in a comfortable chair with her back supported and do the BP measuring. The BP cuff is tied to her arm, which is placed at the level of her heart, and the BP is checked, and it should be checked twice, that is 4 to 6 hours apart. What are the symptoms of hypertension in pregnancy? The first, of course, would be high BP readings. This can only be detected if the mother has proper ANC visits, regular ANC visits. The second one would be swelling of the ankle and the feet, which does not get relieved by proper rest. And the swelling could also occur in the face, in the hands, and in the abdomen when the condition worsens. The doctor would ideally say that I have difficulty in wearing my footwear, or difficulty in wearing my ring, or my watch has become tight. But swelling of the feet is not the diagnostic criteria for preeclampsia, because swelling is a very common complication in pregnancy that many patients would have. But of course, if the swelling were to increase in severity, or it would increase to shift to different parts of the body, for example, the abdomen and the face, then it is an ominous sign and the patient should visit the doctor immediately. We also test the patient for proteinuria. Of all the organs that have been affected, kidneys are one of the organs which get affected by PIH. The primary function of the kidney would be to absorb all the nutrients, filter the essential nutrients, and throw out the toxic waste. But when the kidney becomes damaged, it is not able to contain the proteins, and there would be leakage of the proteins into the urine. Now we check proteinuria, that is leakage of the proteins into the urine, by a dipstick method or by protein analysis. And if the value is 1+, then it is titled as proteinuria. Ophthalmic examination, that is an eye checkup, and blood test to look out for renal function test, that is kidney function test, and liver function test, coagulation profile, is also done. Are there any warning symptoms when the patient should ideally visit the doctor? Yes. When the patient sees that she has blood in her urine, very low amount of urine, when she has continuous headache which is not relieved by rest or by analgesics, epigastric pain with vomiting, And the patient would also say, I have blurring vision, I cannot see anything properly, or I have spots in front of my eyes. And sometimes the attender also complains that the patient is very sleepy, excessively drowsy. With regards to the baby, a very low fetal kick count or a high fetal kick count, or a history of having any pain abdomen or bleeding PV is also an ominous sign, and the patient should visit the doctor immediately. As I have already mentioned, the first symptom would be increase in the BP readings. But the initiation of the disease, that is the pathophysiology of the disease, would have started much more earlier during the time of implantation. Implantation is a time when the baby gets fixed to the wall of the uterus. Lot of research has gone into identifying mothers who are at risk of developing PIH. The first and the foremost would be a primigravida, that is a woman becoming pregnant for the first time, and or a woman who is becoming pregnant for the first time with a new partner, that is new paternity. And the second one would be related to the age, that is either a teenage pregnancy or a elderly woman, that is a woman more than 35 years becoming pregnant for the first time. This woman would have a lot of comorbid medical conditions as well as endocrine issues. And weight is a risk factor, wherein if the BMI is more than 35 kg per meter square, that would be an added risk factor. And multiple gestation, that is more than one fetuses in the uterus, and molar pregnancy is also a risk factor. And women having history, family history of hypertension in pregnancy, in their mothers or siblings would be at more risk. One more, the last risk factor would be a woman who has had PIH in her previous pregnancy at an earlier gestational age. She could have the repeat of the same scenario of or an exaggerated version of PIH in this pregnancy. So the next question in all of our minds would be, what is the effect of PIH on the baby? So the basic pathophysiology is abnormal placental development, where there is decreased blood flow to the placenta and hence decreased blood flow to the baby. Placenta is like a barrier between the mother and the child. The placenta, the child absorbs its nutrition and oxygen from the mother through the placenta, and the baby throws out the toxic waste into the mother through the placenta. So if the placenta is affected, the amount of nutrients going from the mother through the placenta into the baby is decreased, and this causes growth restriction. Growth restriction is something where the growth is not sufficient for that particular gestation or for that particular week of the baby. This leads to a low birth weight baby, and there will be a decrease in the amount of water around the baby, that is inadequate lica. And if termination has to be done in preeclampsia, if the mother's condition worsens, then that would lead to a premature delivery of baby, leading to a premature newborn, which again has many complications like respiratory complications or cerebrovascular complications. In cases of eclampsia and abruptio placentae, sometimes we might lose the baby as well. Treatment of hypertension would depend upon what kind of hypertension she has. For example, in preeclampsia, it would depend upon many factors. The first one would be how much is the BP reading. If it is more than 140 by 90 millimeters of mercury, with 90 being the diastolic, and that is the most important. And the second would be the gestational age of the baby, that is the weeks of pregnancy the woman is into, and if there are any added complications or any other organs which are being damaged, and also the fetal condition. If the preeclamptic patient were to have BP within control, and the fetal well-being is also good, and there are no other added complications, then we could add a antihypertensive and maintain her BP up till term and deliver her, with continual ANC visits being done to check her BP. But if the diastolic BP were to cross 110 millimeters of mercury, or if she were to develop any complications, or if there is a fetal compromise, then a decision has to be taken in regard to termination of the pregnancy, that is delivery of the baby. In case of chronic hypertension, it is a slightly different management, wherein the patient is already on antihypertensive medication. So the feasibility of this medication with pregnancy is checked. If it is compatible, we continue the medication. Or if the medication were to cause organ damage to the baby, we change the medication which is more compliant with the pregnancy. And if there is and since the hypertension is long standing, we do check out for other organ damages like eye, heart, liver function test are done. Blood tests are being done to monitor all the other end organs, and continual ultrasound monitoring is done to check for the growth of the fetus, and Doppler is being done to check for the blood supply to the fetus. BP monitoring is continued after the pregnancy to check for any high recordings of BP. The prophylactic measures for prevention of PIH. I would stress upon the fact for regular ANC visits to detect early diastolic BP rise and even weight gain. Calcium supplementation and high protein diet is also recommended. Healthy lifestyle with prevention of smoking habits is also recommended. If the patient were to take a low salt diet, inculcate a diet of antioxidants, zinc, magnesium and seafood oil, it is found to have a limited benefit. With so many advances in medical sciences, everybody would be curious to know if there are any markers or screening tests for prediction and prevention of PIH. There are many biophysical, biochemical and clinical tests like Doppler, rollover test, maternal serum of SFLTA and fetal DNA. The proteomics and the transcriptomic markers are still being evaluated. But none of these provide convincing evidence which is of any clinical use. To conclude, hypertensive disorders in pregnancy contribute to around 8 to 10% of all the pregnancies and is one of the leading cause for high fetal and maternal morbidity and mortality. The goal is to prevent cerebrovascular as well as cardiovascular complications. The only way to do it is to increase the awareness among patients regarding the regular ANC visits and proper diet, and also about prevention. Right knowledge is right health. Hope you like this video. Subscribe to our channel for more such videos. Thank you.